Welcome everyone to Wintergatan Wednesdays, where I'm trying to push my personal Sisyphus stone up the mountain. I want to go on a world tour with my band Wintergatan and play live music with the Marble Machine X live on stage. And to make this dream come true, there's a lot to do. And earlier I have been working on the marble funnels that make a huge mechanical sound. And I've been trying this kind of liquid rubber product, but I only had access to these small packages. And now we have this one. This is a huge 5-liter bucket where we can dip the funnel straight in. So that's what we're going to do today. I'm going to record the sound of the funnels before I do the rubber treatment. So I have two microphones, SM57 here, Erlen condensator here. Here's the sound in the camera mic. Here's the Erlen condensator. And here's a Shure SM57. You can see where I'm scrubbing here, how loud the funnel is, especially in the condensator microphone. As you heard in these examples, the Shure SM57 is the obvious mic of choice here. I'm just using a condensator microphone alongside with it to show you the difference of microphone types and microphone placements regarding to the signal to noise discussion we're having here. When I designed this, I really wanted the two halves to meet right here. But now I don't want these to bang into each other when a marble opens the funnel. So I'm actually gonna cut off these extra. So we will have distance between the two halves. That will be better for the sound. I cut the funnels and now I can try dip for the first time ever. I have a very professional mask that I actually ordered for this purpose, because this stuff is poisonous. I read the instruction and it's a little bit too hot in this room. It's summer in south of France. I can't really do anything about it. I hope it won't mess everything up. Knowing what happens usually when I take shortcuts, it will of course mess everything up. So, let's go! This is very exciting. Woot woot! Oh, this is amazing! Wow! I think it's too warm in the room. Very thick. Just like that. Oh, that's so nice. In you go. Okay, they're all done. It's time for the Cyberbase Mega Dip. Oh, yeah. Woot, woot.
I had real issues getting the liquid rubber to flow easily in my warm and super dry room. Perhaps this is just the normal viscosity of this product, but I am suspecting my room made it worse. So sometimes it ended up in these ugly drips. And I wanted the funnels to be like meat-eating flowers, so let's call this morning dew, shall we?
I'm brushing out the morning dew. First coating is done. And I think it looks pretty good, actually.
The poisonous smell of this product spread in my entire house, and I waited for midnight to do the second coating outdoors. I hoped for a colder weather, but again, south of France, it's like 27 degrees in the night, so it didn't really help. But I found a nice technique to dip the funnel and then beat the excess off really fast by just throwing the funnels towards the ground in a whipping motion. That really made the best result. I wish I used this technique already on the first coat. When I was done with the second coating of all the funnels, half of my blood had been sucked out of my body by the French vampire mosquitoes, and I closed the studio for the day. And while the second coat is drying, I want to tell you all about a new free download section that we have on the Wintergatan.net website. We've added some fun stuff that you can download for free or pay something for it if you want to. You can download the CAD files of Wilson, you can download my handwriting font, all the released Wintergatan music, and some other stuff. And we plan to release more and more digital files on this section. We have some exciting stuff coming up in the future also. We will let you know when we add new stuff here. So check out Wintergatan.net for some fun downloads. And now back to the funnels and the third coating.
For the third coating, I run my portable AC
and I think the room is actually below 20 degrees right now. So I hope the rubber will flow better. This is the finish from yesterday. Not super bad. Here I'm removing all the excess rubber that peels off really, really easily and putting all the funnels together before assembling them back onto the Marble Machine X.
It's time for the moment of truth. Has this made a big difference?
Here's the camera mic before. Camera mic after. Erlund mic before. Erlund mic after. SM57 before. SM57 after.
Great result, it's made a huge difference. Let's listen to the bass funnel. That is also really much better actually. I have two more tricks. The start pipe you see here is 10 centimeters. So I'm putting together a 48 centimeter pipe. And then we can tune this resonator just like you tune flute, tvärflöjt in Swedish.
Flute.
This is like a minor third. No, 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 da, 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 da. It's like this note. You can even hear the resonator reacting. But we want this note, so when we add the 10 centimeters, let's listen. That's a little high, do you hear that? No, 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 no. I'm gonna slide it out a little bit. Now we have a volume boost in the signal from the resonator pipes, which hopefully will help us in the signal to noise war that we're fighting. Let's try.
Here you can hear clearly how the resonator pipe is adding stability and volume to the fundamental frequency of the note. When checking the SM57, I noticed that the difference was more subtle in this particular case, but you can still hear it clearly. When looking at the frequencies, you can see the lowest fundamental being much louder with the resonator. Still, it's kind of subtle. So here you can hear the different harmonics. The top one is actually the harmonic we reduced the volume when we switched the hit positions, like last century. And there is something going on in my ears, because when I listen at the end of the tail of this note, it sounds to me like there's a pitch shifting going on, like no, no. It's almost like a semitone in my ears. I don't know if it's an effect or if the resonator pipe is actually not in tune. If I cut up this region a little bit, I should be able to play the Jaws theme with one single tone. That should not be possible. Maybe it's just me, I'm moving on from this right now. I just thought it was an interesting little thing to mention. No major worries here at all.
Okay, so the resonator pipe helps, and now I'm going to try something. I'm going to remove this rubber pad, because I think they're a little bit too thick. I think I made them a little bit too muffly, so they reduce the volume of the attack. And for my ears, this is going to be super sharp. But maybe in the SM57 dynamic microphone, this will just add the clarity we need. Otherwise, I will use a thinner rubber pad. And if you've been following, we had a problem with the super jumps where the marbles are jumping over the funnels. My hope is that reducing the thickness of this rubber pad will make the bounce worse, which will stop these super jumps.
As you can see, the marbles are not jumping at all without the pads, so we're definitely going to have a little bit of a pad, but I like a little bit more attack here, so I'm looking forward to experiment with the thickness of the pad in the future. Here's the SM57, I've reduced the volume to save your ears. I added some reverb and reduced the treble of this last note, and I don't like the sound of this sharp attack, but you can hear that we have completely removed the funnel sound in the SM57 right now anyway. Just for fun, let's make a stupid comparison between the first condensator mic and the last SM57.
This was a great result. This format worked much better than these. We have a whole video of me using these products, but now we're home and dry and it feels really good. We can close this chapter. So here comes the South Park learning moment. I think we learned something here today. And my design confidence right now is very, very low. Or I shouldn't say it like that. I should say that I'm annoyed with my previous design choices, because what I learned from this is that when you add constraints to a design, for example, cheap, it has to go fast, it has to be good, meaning it has to look good or it has to sound good. Often in my world, when I try to solve a problem, I just think, okay, I need to solve all those constraints. But what I've realized more and more and more, the trick is to remove constraint. Okay, and simple constraint is, it doesn't have to be cheap, right? Okay, we have all the money in the world. Okay, that makes it easier. You can also remove fast, so it doesn't have to be cheap and fast, which is how I've been doing this whole machine. What I really have to learn is to remove constraints, for example, look good. So what happened today is that the movement is way worse now when the sound is better, because DCS gets so much more heavy, so the marble has not enough mass and energy to really move the funnels as they did before. In this process, it would have been much better if I really thought it through from the beginning, and I really thought through what was most important. Is the sound constraint more important than the aesthetical movement constraint? I didn't think so. I did a wrong prioritization from the beginning. So by prioritizing your design constraints, and most of all, removing some constraints if you can, you will end up with a much smoother design process. I'm really fed up with adding fixes to like fundamentally flawed designs. Can't wait until I can design something new with what I've learned, with a more mature, less optimistic idea about design constraints. I think it can help you a lot in whatever work you're doing to put down the constraints. What do I actually need the result to be and why? And can I compromise on some things? And this is also like me being perfectionist. I didn't want to remove a single constraint on a single piece. This machine has 10,000 pieces. So if I'm not removing design constraints for any of the 10,000 pieces, they all have to look good, they all have to sound good, they all have to have a cool material, they all have to The machine never gets finished. So I'm so surprised by how long this learning curve has been for me. It's also part of my creativity, it's part of my expression as an artist. I want this to look like nothing else and work like nothing else. which makes it harder and take longer time. But I have to say that I've been fighting some battles that I should never have picked. That's what we learned today, kids. Stainless steel, no problem. I so wish Stan or Kyle could have been here to deliver that to you. I mean, this also would be like some really cheesy music to it. It's always like... You know, I think we learned something today. Maybe all the sound constraints doesn't have to be included. Thanks to everyone watching, and thanks to the patrons and the YouTube members. I've been spending this whole week making music in my new music studio, so I picked a little fast one-day project to show you from the Marble Machine X build. I'm saving the music for the album. My music studio is making me want to make music more than it makes me want to build. I really want to make this transition, and it's going to happen eventually. But we still have a lot of issues on the Marble Machine X Sisyphus Stone.